Teach me, O Lord, the way of your statutes, and I'll keep it to the end. Give me understanding that I may keep your law and observe it with my whole heart. Lead me in the path of your commandments, for I delight in it. Incline my heart to your testimonies and not to selfish gain. Turn my eyes from looking at worthless things and give me life in your ways. Father, we honor and we recognize your presence in our lives today. Father, may we cherish the cross and the sacrifice that was displayed for all to see and that saved a wretch like me. I pray that through our worship that it will expose our need for you and areas of weakness that not only by your hand can it be turned into strength. So Father, we thank you that you've given us a living hope and a grace that pursues us and never lets us go. I pray that you will use me and that there will be more of you and less of me at all times. God, that in my weakness, Father, that you will be my strength. We pray this in the name that is above all names, Jesus Christ alone, and it's in his name we pray. Amen. Amen. You know, they say in the season of matrimony, there are three rings that are represented in that time frame. The first one is the engagement ring. Now, for the women, this is something that many of them have dreamed all their lives. You know, I once knew a girl who was so obsessed with an engagement ring that she made it the wallpaper of her desktop. And so she would look at it every day and she would pray that the man of her dreams would come and bring that exact ring and propose to her. But for us guys, you know, this is a lot of pressure, isn't it? To come up with not only the money, but also to find the right ring. We want to impress our future wife with this ring. And so this ring is very special. And they say that the engagement ring should cost about how much you earn in 3 months. So for me as a youth pastor, this wasn't much, you know. It's like the size of a little pebble. And so, you know, when I proposed to my wife, it was special because she didn't see it coming. You know, the whole time I kept playing my youth pastor card and I was saying, you know, I'm not going to make a lot of money, so I don't think I can afford an engagement ring. So I kept planting that seed in her mind. So she's like, oh, don't worry about it. You know, I don't need an engagement ring. I don't know if deep down she was really expecting one, but I kept saying that. And so she kept believing it. And so I flew out to Guam, which is where she was at, with the intention of proposing to her. So I was going to surprise her. Now, I said that I was going to visit, but I was going to use that as a time to pop out my engagement ring. And it happened that the day before I scheduled to propose, we got into this huge argument. And so for you guys, this is a great opportunity to bring up, say, oh, you know, I want, and I apologize. I'm like, oh, I'm so sorry that there was this miscommunication. So I said, let me make it up to you. So tomorrow I'll take you out somewhere special, all right? So why don't you get all dressed up? In fact, why don't you wear the dress where I first met you in, right? Let's make it extra special. She's like, okay, okay. She's like all excited and all happy. And so afterwards, you know, I took her to church and I proposed to her because that was the first place where we met. And so when I think about the engagement ring, you know, it brings back a lot of good memories. Just all the, you know, the fond memories of courting her and realizing how much I'm falling in love with this person. And so that's the first ring. That's the engagement ring. Now, the second ring is the marriage ring. And it's a season in your lives where you begin to realize that your life is no longer your own. But now you're committed to this person and the two become one. And so, you know, every decision that you make involves the other person. It affects them. So even now, my life, I notice that it's no longer my life, but it's her life as well. You know, for instance, I trust my wife so much, especially in the area of finance, that, you know, ever since coming to Korea, I haven't been able to figure out the banking situation, so I completely trust her. Like, I don't even know how much is in our account. I don't know how we pay the bills, but I just completely trust her and say that, you know, you're in charge. You know, I'll put my life in your hands. And so she takes care of all that. And so I feel free. You know, I don't have to worry about how much money I have, but I just know that I'm surviving. All right? So that's the first two rings. And so some of you are like, what's the third ring? All right. Well, the third ring is called suffering. You did that. All right, before I get in trouble, okay? I've been married for 11 years, so I'll choose my words carefully, right? I'm not saying that once you get married, we'll create suffering, but what I'm trying to say is that once you get married, you have someone to suffer with, all right? And so that season of suffering, you have someone to hold on to and to go through life together. Amen, brothers? Amen. All right. Well, it's true, though, that since getting married, I don't see suffering the same way, because now I have someone who is beside me, who understands and can help me and carry me through those difficult times. And, you know, as we look in today's passage, Paul understood suffering very well. I'm sure if he had to write up a resume on suffering, our resume would not compare to Paul's. You know, apart from Christ, I'm sure it would be very difficult to measure up to his standards. And as Paul is writing this letter in 2 Corinthians, he feels like giving up. And so he's taken a beating physically, and he's compelled to write this letter, this passage, that starts off in chapter 4, verse 1, as, "Therefore, having this ministry by the mercy of God, we do not lose heart." So he sounds weathered. He sounds beaten. It seems like he's at the end of his rope in terms of ministry. But he gives us a glimpse of hope at the end of the sentence. And this is why we cannot give up. This is why I believe he explains this in the following verses. So if you have your Bibles or your Bible app, let's turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 7 to 18. And the title of today's message is Suffering as a Tool for Ministry. And the first thing that we're going to see in this passage is that our suffering reveals God's power. Right? Our suffering reveals God's power. Now, it starts off in verse 7. It says, "But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that the surpassing power belongs to God and not to us." So Paul uses this image of jars of clay to describe to us this treasure, which is called the gospel. And it's inside of all of us. We call ourselves Christians. We call ourselves believers. As followers of Christ, all of us have the gospel living inside of us. And so Paul uses this image of jars of clay to show how common and frail this container was. Which they use all the time. And so this was very inexpensive, and it was also easily broken. And so unlike metal, which can be repaired, or glass, which can be melted down and reused, jars of clay, once they were broken, had to be discarded. Therefore, they were cheap, and they had little value. So everyone had it, and you knew that it's a one-time use. So Paul does not describe this jar as a Ming vase, you know, that's made of porcelain or expensive china, but he describes it as clay pots that can get easily chipped, cracked, and broken if dropped. And if you have this Ming vase, you put it somewhere safe. You know, you would put it in a display case, you know, it would have metal detectors, it would have sensors to make sure that no one gets too close to this. Because we know that as jars of clay, like our lives, as we get older, life takes its toll. Our physical bodies are not made to last forever. And what's more important, however, is what's inside this jar. You know, it reminds me when I was growing up in the States. You know, sometimes I would go grocery shopping with my mom. And one of the things that I saw as a treat was sometimes my mom let me choose which cereal we get to eat during the month. All right, so whenever I approached the cereal aisle, you know what really stuck out to me? You know what motivated me to choose a certain brand or a certain cereal? You know, it wasn't based on the nutritional value. You know, I didn't pick up a box of it, okay, this has such and such amount of grams of fiber and grain. Oh, that's going to be really healthy for me. You know, as a kid, you don't think about that. And you don't think about how much it costs, right? But for me as a kid growing up, what made me choose a certain cereal was what was inside the cereal. Right? And so when I would look at the box, I would go from one box, one aisle, and I would look at each box and I would see what was the prize inside of that cereal. And if it was something I liked, that's the one I chose. Right? And so as soon as I got home, when it's time for breakfast, you know, I don't know how people have the patience to do this, but, you know, some people would eat the cereal slowly, slowly, until that prize just all of a sudden just pops out, right? But for me as a kid, that was the first thing I looked for, right? I would even empty out all what's in that, inside that box, and I would empty it out until I found that prize. And like, yes, this is what I was going for, right? I was so excited. I would do anything. I would empty. I didn't care what kind of mess I made, because that prize was so valuable to me. In fact, I'm willing to bet that prize was worth more than all the cereal that's inside that box, isn't it? And that's what I was choosing for. And I think this is what Paul is getting at. He's saying that our lives aren't what's valuable. He's saying what's inside of you is more valuable. It's the prize, the gospel that's living inside of you, that is what will last forever. Your bodies will not last forever. You know, everyone, we know that death is unavoidable. We all know that one day we will end up in the grave. But the gospel goes on. The gospel is still living. It is more valuable than our lives. And then he goes on, verse 8 to 9. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not driven to despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed. So these verses give a description of his experiences, and it gives us an idea of what Paul went through doing ministry day in and day out. Afflicted, meaning that he was being tormented in every way imaginable. Can you imagine being tormented for what you're doing? He's saying he's perplexed, showing that he was confused. He was wondering, you know, what is God doing in my life? And I'm sure many of you may feel that at some point in your lives. He was persecuted, meaning he was victimized for his faith. Struck down, probably meaning he was smashed every day of his life. So Paul here, he's being honest. And he doesn't leave anything out from this list. Can you imagine what it must have felt like to be in Paul's shoes? It sounds like he's barely hanging on. Have you ever been in a near-death experience? And I feel as though that he's giving that kind of description in these verses. You know, recently I saw on TV, and I was flipping through the channels, and I happened to come across this show called American Gladiators. You guys remember that show? I remember this was a show that I grew up watching, but now they remade it. And this time, it was hosted by Hulk Hogan. Right? And it's crazy. Like, this show, they had these contestants that had to go through different obstacles. And they had to face these gigantic mammoths. You know, these guys are like freak of natures. They belong in a, you know, bodybuilding competition, all right? You know, they have legs the size of our waists, all right? And they have like muscles and veins just popping out of everywhere, even on their forehead. They were huge. And these guys would come and they would give them hell, basically, right? They would beat them up, they would curse them, they would yell at them, they would berate them. They would do everything possible. The goal of these gladiators was to punish them and to let them know how they're doing it. And it makes me wonder, these contestants, they're tiny. You know, they would give their bio like, you know, I'm a school teacher teaching, you know, kindergarten kids, you know. And these guys are not, they're puny, they're tiny. And they had to go up against these giants, these Goliaths. And they're getting punished, verbally abused. And I wonder, what possesses these people to go through that? Why would you sign up for this contest? Do you know why? It's because they know there's a prize at the end. You know, they could easily give up. They could say, I did not sign up for this. These guys are not what I thought they would be. You know, take me off the show. But the reason why they sign up is because they want to get to that prize. They want to finish in first place. And that should be all of us as Christians. And we know there's going to be difficulties. We know that we're going to get persecuted. We know we're going to be made fun of. We know even some of us may even go to jail. But we do this because there's a prize at the end. And it goes on in verse 10 to 12. It says, always carrying in the body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be manifested in our bodies. For we who live are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus may be manifested in our mortal flesh. So death is at work in us, but life in you. So in these verses, he's giving us that there is life in death. Paul sums up his near-death experiences with the fact that there is life. That even though death and our weakness seems to be overwhelming in our eyes, he's saying there's still life, isn't there? That's the all-surpassing power that Paul is talking about in this passage. But the second thing that we see, he's also revealing that our suffering reveals that we are not alone. Our suffering reveals that we are not alone. Look with me in verse 13 to 15. It says, since we have the same spirit of faith, according to what has been written, I believed and so I spoke. We also believe and so we also speak, knowing that he who raised Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and bring us with you into his presence. For it is all for your sake, so that as grace extends to more and more people, it may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God. And I love the way that Paul phrases it here in verse 13. Since we have the same spirit of faith. Brothers and sisters, we are all in this together. Okay? If you can turn to your neighbor and say, we're in this together. All right? Turn to your neighbor and say, we're in this together. You see, Paul is quoting from Psalm 116:10. And from this reference, he's showing that we're not alone. Do you know why? Because Paul is taking comfort in knowing that this psalmist was also going through suffering and affliction, which he writes about. And so this leads him to be able to write and say how God has also delivered him from these afflictions. If Paul could take comfort in the psalmist's afflictions, that means we also can take comfort in Paul's afflictions. We must share with others how God has delivered us from our sufferings. You know, a translation of Psalm 116:10 reads like this. I held firm to my faith and was vindicated. Therefore, I have spoken. You know, there was a period in my life where I remember when my wife was pregnant with our first child. And I remember her when she was going through a lot of difficulties. She was going through emotional struggles and transitions. You know, and as a loving husband, I tried to be there for her. But I just couldn't do everything I could. You know, I tried, but I just didn't have what it took for her to feel comforted. But there was one day where a friend of mine, she brought over a friend who also recently just gave birth. And so, you know, I went outside to take care of some errands. And so they had a time where they can just share and talk and just let out what they were going through. So this person was a complete stranger that came into our house. And they just spent some time talking. They were sharing, you know, how the pregnancy went. They were sharing, you know, how difficult it was to feed their child. You know, they were talking about how the difficulties of having jaundice and all these things. And so I remember when I came back into the house, they were just crying, they were bawling, they were hugging each other. And I was like, what just happened? You know, like, I just stepped out for a moment. But here I saw that they bonded together. Because the sufferings that my wife was going through, this lady understood. Because she went through the same things. And so she was able to show empathy and sympathy towards my wife. And I saw what took place there. And I was so thankful. But it showed me that this is what happens when we suffer and we learn and we grow from it, that we also can help others. And now I see how my wife goes and comforts and helps those who are new moms as well. And I see how all this takes place and the cycle continues on and on. And it's amazing. And this is why I titled this message, Suffering as a Tool for Ministry. Because many times we see suffering as a stigma. You know, we don't want others to know what we're going through. We don't want people into our lives when it's most difficult. But over the years, I've realized that perhaps God allows us to suffer so that we can minister to them. And this is what made Christ such an effective missionary, because he took on flesh and he was able to identify with our sufferings and the temptations in life. And that's why I remember one of our resurrection services, Resurrection Sunday services, we had people from our congregation come up and we had a time of cardboard testimonies. And so they would come up on stage and on this piece of cardboard, they would write what their lives were like before they met Christ. And then afterwards, they would flip it over and it would show and reveal what they were now. And they could show it with a smile, with genuine joy, expressing what Christ has done for them. And I felt like I could celebrate with them, seeing how that they not only overcame it, but through the power of Christ, they were able to live new lives. And that they were able to boast about what Christ has done in their lives. I also believe that it helped people to identify with others who struggle with those same exact things in their lives. If you look at 2 Corinthians 1, verse 3 to 7, I'll read that for us. It said, Blessed by the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our affliction, so that we may be able to comfort those who are in affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. For as we share abundantly in Christ's sufferings, so through Christ we share abundantly in comfort too. If we are afflicted, it is for your comfort and salvation. And if we are comforted, it is for your comfort, which you experience when you patiently endure the same sufferings that we suffer. Our hope for you is unshaken, for we know that as you share in our sufferings, you also share in our comfort. And I'm just so blown away by these verses, that this gives me idea and realization of what our sufferings and how we can be used as a tool to help those who are suffering as well. But the third thing that we also see here is that our suffering reveals an eternal perspective. So our suffering reveals God's power, our suffering reveals that we're not alone, and our suffering reveals an eternal perspective. And it comes from verse 16 to 18. It says, so we do not lose heart. Though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this light, momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison, as we look not to the things that are seen, but the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. So now Paul supplies us with this reason for his refusal to grow discouraged. That despite overwhelming odds, he still had faith. The reason how he can still keep going on and on each day. That even though he feels like he's too beat up to continue on, he supplies this reason. And if you notice in verse 16, he writes this phrase again. So we do not lose heart. So you notice this is a repeat from verse 1. We do not lose heart. He's saying, I'm not going to give up. I refuse to give up because of what is ahead of me, what I can look forward to. Not only is he reminding his readers not to give up their ministry or their faith in the midst of suffering, but I believe he's also talking to himself as well. I believe he's reminding himself these things. He's saying that the church is not his. The ministry is not his. And his life is not his. That everything belongs to God and God alone. You see, if we try to overcome these things on our own, who gets the glory? We do. But when we rely on God to help us during those difficult times, who gets the glory? God does. That even though our sufferings chips away at our mortal bodies, it may cause, you know, our hair to fall out. We may lose sleep. It can create aches and pains in our bodies. But He's saying He is renewed day by Jesus Christ. Why? Because our troubles are momentary. Our troubles will pass away. In verse 18, God is giving us a solution for not giving up. As we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. Saying, don't let your afflictions and your sufferings have the last word. Look at what Paul says. He says, do not lose heart. Focus on what is eternal, not on what is temporary, because these things will go away. Paul experienced spiritual renewal every single day. You know what's probably one of the fastest ways to feel depressed? Is when you focus on your problems. When you remind yourself that you have no friends. When you remind yourself you don't look as pretty or as handsome as this world might seem. Or when you remind yourself that you had an abusive parent or an abusive relationship. Nobody loves you. You see what Paul says here. He's saying, fix your eyes on what is unseen. How do we do that? By coming to the Lord in prayer. By fixing our eyes on the cross. By saying that He is greater than our problems. And that is how we can help to overcome the state that we're in. So can we do that together? Let's pray. Father, we know that in every wound there is pain. We thank You for Your Son Jesus who understood pain and is able to understand our suffering. God, I pray for us today that we will not waste our suffering, but we'll see how we can give God the glory in all circumstances. Father, we know that when we focus on the pain, God, that it screams out and it makes life very difficult. But Lord, when we learn to focus on You, when we learn to lift them up, when we learn to surrender these things to the cross and to our Savior, we understand that it becomes bearable. And so God, I pray that You will lift the weight off our shoulders. God, that You will take away all the burdens. That You will help us to see that we're not meant to do this alone. And so God, I pray that we'll be sensitive to our brothers and sisters who may be going through what we did. But God, we thank You that as we learn to overcome them, God, use us as a tool for ministry, to be sensitive to those around us who are going through similar situations, that we could be simply a presence to them, that we could surround them with comfort, that as we have been comforted, God, help us to comfort others and learn to be Christ to them. And that is what we're called to do. And so, Father, give us that eternal perspective. Help us, God, to see beyond what we see today. Help us to look into the future, for we know that You're calling us into Your glory and into Your presence. And now to Him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us that comforts us and reveals His presence to us, to Him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.